Let's continue the lecture to the fourth lecture. This lecture will be conducted by Dr. Maulidiani. She is a lecturer from Faculty of Science and Marine Environment, University Malaysia Terengganu in Malaysia. Her background is about natural product chemistry and metabolomics. To Dr. Maulidiani, time is yours.
Thank you, Miss Rizzi. Yeah.
Yes. Oh, sorry, so, I forgot to introduce myself.
Yeah, for your kind introduction. So let me share my slide first. Right. All right. Anyone can see the slide now?
It's still loading. Okay.
All right. So I make it full screen here.
Dr. Diani,
yes.
Is it possible if in the middle of the class, maybe around 45 minutes, we have a break for or 10 minutes?
Sure, yes.
For pray or have a coffee?
What time is that? You want to take a break? What time?
Maybe four.
Or I just make it fast, make it a quick lecture, very probably.
No, you don't have to be really quick.
All right. I think I just start. Yeah, start this class. So, very good evening to everyone. So once again, I like to thanks the organizing for inviting me to this. For me, sharing session, yeah, in this summer school, right? For today, I would like to share my little experience and also knowledge, and my area of study, yeah, which is metabolomics. So as been introduced by Miss Rizzi, that I am a lecturer at the Faculty of Science and Marine Environment, University Malaysia Terengganu. So for today, we will discuss about this topic, which is metabolomic for safety quality assessment. So it's also feel free for you if, for example, you want to interrupt or you want to ask a question. Okay. So I hope that through this class, you all will know about what is a metabolomic, the definition of metabolomic and its use and also application. I also can explain what are the analytical instruments and also method in metabolomic. Lastly, I hope that you can relate the use of metabolomic in the safety quality assessment of seafood. So, some of you probably know about metabolomic, but to some maybe it's new, right? So what is metabolomic? So according to its definition, metabolomic is a comprehensive evaluation or study of all metabolites, which are here dedicated to small metabolites, quantitatively and also qualitatively in a living organism at certain time and under certain condition. So why is that under certain time and under certain condition? Probably this picture can give you a better understanding of that. So because of here, the metabolites in organism can be varied according to many factors. Yeah? So this picture illustrates the metabolism in human that can be altered by some factor, for example, age, right? And the environment, disease, nutrition, drug, lifestyle, and so on. So I think previous speaker also discussed about genomic or I don't know, proteomic if not mistaken. So I just want to review back. So what is genomic basically is to provide an overview of the complete set of genes, right? Like a DNA, while the transcriptomic here is looking at into gene expression patterns As for the proteomics here, it's a study of dynamic protein product and their interaction. So in here, metabolomics is try to understand the metabolism in organism. I must say that this metabolomics is a beneficial and ideal tool for the analysis of primary and secondary metabolites. And also, the role of metabolomics is providing a data of metabolome for the integration with other data sets. For example, here is genome, yeah, transcriptome, and proteome. So let's recall back what is primary and secondary metabolites, right? So primary metabolites are the metabolites that directly involve in normal growth, okay, and then development and also reproduction. Can you tell me what are the example of primary metabolites? Anyone? All right, the primary metabolite, yeah, I think most of you know already. Yes, the primary metabolites that we know are such as like carbohydrate, amino acids, nucleosides, organic acid, and also lipids, right? On the other hand, although the secondary metabolites are not directly involved in the process like in the primary metabolites, but these secondary metabolites are essential and have the important ecological function, okay? For example, some secondary metabolites in plant are used as the mechanism of defense against the pathogen or stress. So when can we apply metabolomics? In here, the application of metabolomics are diverse, yeah, and has been used in many fields of study. For example, like in food chemistry for the quality control assessment, clinical toxicology, environment, and so on. So we may use metabolomic approach for metabolite fingerprint and chemical profile of the sample, for example, from different species or different origin, then to evaluate the metabolite changes due to chemicals or drug intervention. We can also use this metabolomic as a prediction model to study the relationship between the metabolite and the biological activities. Also, it all has the benefit to be used as the tool for chemotaxonomy study, and also the important use of this tool is for the to propose their biosynthetic pathway analysis, so that this metabolomic is very useful as a tool for the quality control and standardization. So these are some important factors and have been concerned in pharmaceutical and food products, yeah, that including safety. So what are the attribute of safety, for example, here? Yes, safety means that the food, for example, that we eat that has no harm or dangerous component, has no toxic metabolite. So this is safety, yeah, related to safety. How about the quality? So the quality perhaps is attributed to taste, shape, size, but the most important is nutrition, for example, if it's in food product. In addition, for in the pharmaceutical product, we also concern about the efficacy and consistency. Yeah, this is the important factor, yeah, in the pharmaceutical product. So for this purpose, we may use metabolomic. To perform metabolomic, we need a suitable analytical platform. So these are the common analytical platforms instrument, yeah, which is the based on spectroscopy analysis that has been used widely in metabolomic study. Of course, every instrument has their own purpose and advantages. Yeah, for example, here, like nuclear magnetic resonance, NMR, is a widely used for the chemical profile that can determine the chemical structure. Usually, we use this NMR in non-targeted metabolomic analysis. As for example, here, LCMS, liquid chromatography mass spectrometry, is widely used for targeted and non-targeted analysis. It also can give chemical structure identification. For the GCMS, here, gas chromatography mass spectrometry, is widely used for the detection of volatile compound and can be used in targeted as well as non-targeted metabolomic. So a very simple spectroscopy tool like FTIR here for the transform infrared also can be used in metabolomic. Usually we use this FTIR, for example, for the chemical fingerprint analysis. It can detect the functional groups of the metabolites. So there's two approaches in metabolomics, which are targeted and non-targeted, which I have mentioned earlier. All right. So what are the differences So usually in targeted metabolomic, the purpose is to quantify non-metabolites that will be the biomarkers or chemical markers of the samples. For instance, here, analysis of the metabolites that involve in particular metabolic pathway. So for this targeted, usually we use MS platform. Yeah? So for non-targeted, usually we want to identify as many as possible the metabolites in the sample. Yeah, that could be known and also unknown metabolites. So the purpose of this non-targeted is more to metabolite profiling or fingerprint. So at the end, in this non-targeted analysis, we want to discover the chemical markers or biomarkers of the particular samples. Yeah. So this non-targeted metabolomic, LCMS or MS based and NMR is probably we can use it. So for some of us maybe wondering what are the differences between NMR and LCMS analysis. So this table we have a summarized. This is good for you to know the strength and weakness, so that you may decide and choose which between these two techniques that's suitable for your study. Okay, for example here, for the NMR, yeah, and LCMS or MS-based, both are universal detector. However, for MS technique is limited to the ionizable molecules. But again, in terms of reproducibility, NMR high reproducibility, low reproducibility for MS, but in terms of sensitivity, NMR has low sensitivity as compared to MS technique. And then MS technique, of course, has high resolution, has high resolution as compared to NMR. But the resolution in NMR could be improved, for example, using 2D method for the identification purpose. And also, we can increase the number of scan in NMR experiment. And you can use higher frequency of NMR machine in order to improve the resolution and sensitivity. Okay, both of these analytical platform can be used in quantitative analysis. So for the preparation, I would like to say that NMR is more easy in the sample preparation as compared to MS. In MS, you might require to after you dilute the sample, you may require to filter the sample, using a specific membrane filter, for example. And then both of this technique can give the structural information to identify metabolites. Lastly, for NMR technique is a non-destructive method, which means that the sample that you have analyzed in NMR, you can use it for another analysis if you like. Indeed, the structural elucidation of metabolites in the mixture or extract is a challenging task. This because in metabolite identification is not only limited to the identification of the primary and secondary metabolites, but you may also deal with non-constitutive metabolite, and other metabolites that probably coexist in the samples. So this kind of factor you need to take into account when you do the metabolite identification. So in this case, to help you to identify the metabolites, you can use available library, which is online or offline. And also you need to compile the information about any upper structure of the metabolite from the previous study. So here I have summarized in this table some of the software for NMR and MS-based metabolomic that probably you can use for the spectral pre-processing as well as for the identification of the metabolites. Maybe you can explore by yourself later on. Okay, so let me continue. This flowchart describes the general metabolic workflow that usually we will follow in carry out the metabolomic study. The first is sample collection. All right, so you may need to extract the sample, then you can proceed for the sample analysis using the appropriate or suitable analytical tools in your study. And then after you the data obtained, we may need to do data pre-processing, which including, for example, if in NMR metabolomic, You need to do baseline correction, facing, line broadening, alignment. So these are some of the example in NMR metabolomic. And then after that, then you extract the data, then you subjected the data for multivariate analysis. So for this multivariate analysis, we will discuss later. Yeah. Lastly, after we get the result, we may interpret the data. Okay, probably do some correlation study of the chemical and biological activity, as well as metabolic pathway analysis. Probably is depending on your purpose. So for metabolomic, you may require replicate, yeah. So not only one sample that you perform, yeah, in the analysis of metabolomic. So in here, I must say that biological replicates and technical replicate must be done, yeah. Except for NMR, it doesn't require to do technical replicates. Okay, so you can see here in the picture. So biological replicate means that a different individual. Yeah, if in case here is a experiment related to rats, right? So you must have these replicates, yeah, when you perform metabolomic. So I must say, if you ask how many the number of replicate that require in metabolomic, I think the more is the better. But usually for NMR and the in case of FTIR, we will need 6 biological replicates. For MS, probably minimum, yeah, 3 biological replicates. Okay, I think we can see the video, yeah, and also you can take a break, but while you see the video, let me share first. This is the video for the sample preparation in NMR metabolomic that use the biological sample, which is fish, yeah.
Have you started the video?
But not yet, yeah.
Yeah, it is not starting.
Again, sorry. Is it okay now?
Okay.
Okay. just dry. Sample is ready for the extraction. So we need to extract the sample using deteriorated NMR sulfur. Okay, we have watched the video. I hope everyone now have the idea, yeah, how to prepare. I know it's not probably the same. Maybe different sample will require different method, but at least you get the idea for the sample preparation in the metabolomic. So we want to discuss about multivariate dependencies here. Okay, so, because this multivariate dependencies is a method that integrated in the metabolomic study. Okay, usually in metabolomic study, we will run our sample in analytical instrument. For example, here is NMR. Okay, then we will get the spectral data, something like this. So after we do the pre-processing, just I have mentioned earlier in the metabolomic workflow, then we extract the data and submit it to multivariate analysis. So this is how one of the result, yeah, that we obtain in metabolomic study. This result, we call it as score plot, yeah. As we can see here, in this score plot, they are showing two different cluster at the right side and the left side. So basically, this sample that are close together in one cluster, which means that this sample has the similar chemical characteristic. Same goes with this sample in this cluster. This sample also share the similar characteristic in terms of the chemistry. So if they are far away, which means that they are not similar. Okay, So this is one of the useful tools, yeah, for to know the overall of the sample status. So using these tools, also we can identify the chemical marker or the biologic marker in our sample. So what is multivariate data analysis? So I'm sure anyone has dealing with univariate data analysis. Yeah, for example, using SPSS software. Yeah, like you do t-test, one-way ANOVA. Yeah, so multivariate analysis is the statistical data analysis that involve many or multiple variables. Yeah, so this multivariate analysis is used to study more complex sets of data. And in univariate analysis, which only limited to, for example, one of two variables. Why we need this multivariate data analysis? So I give the illustration here. Yeah, when we do the analysis, then we get the spectroscopy data. You may expect, yeah, to identify, for example, in NMR, 10 to 30 metabolites. In MS, even more, yeah, for example, 50 metabolites. So in NMR, like if you have 30 metabolites, you probably have 200 variables, yeah. This because when we extract the data, we do the backcatting or binning of the data according to the area of bin data, for example 004, yeah, for binning data, so that we obtain 200 variables. Okay, so it's kind of many, you get many variables, yeah, many data. So in here, for example, when you have 30 metabolites, then you need to compare between the different treatment or different species, okay? So you will have many figures, yeah. You have, will have probably data, many data in tables, yeah, which is difficult, yeah, to be evaluated. So in this case, multivariate analysis help us to evaluate all response variable simultaneously, yeah, rather than you requiring multiple execution of multivariate methods. So this is a score plot, yeah, just to give you overview, yeah. So we may get a more simple data interpretation using multivariate data analysis. So there are methods, yeah, many methods that we can use in multivariate data analysis. So here we can separate the two, yeah, by the purpose is which are for the classification. Another one is for the prediction model, which is regression, yeah. So for the classification, also we can separate into two type, which is unsupervised, another one is supervised method, yeah. So in unsupervised models, so the input variables is will be from one measurement, yeah. In here we call it as X variables, yeah. For example, if you run your sample in NMR, so the input variable, which is X variables, are the chemical shifts, okay? As in the supervised model, yeah, the difference compared to the unsupervised model is we have another one input, yeah, which is dependent X variables, yeah, that we can determine based on the information that we obtain, yeah, on the sample. For example, here, you know, your sample is from different species A, B, C, and D, so you can make it class A, B, C, and D, yeah? All right, so for the prediction model, it only has supervised, yeah? But the difference between the prediction model and classification, the input for X, or Y variables is considered to be like continuous from the continuous response, yeah, which means here that you have another measurement, yeah, for example from the biological data, right? So again, in prediction model you have two variable, okay, X variables, for example in NMR is chemical shift, yeah, metabolites. For Y variable in prediction model, you can have biologic activity. So that in here, supervised model, you can do the correlation analysis between the metabolites with the biological activity. So in the next slide, I just want to explain, yeah, about PCA. Yeah? This principal component analysis. Since this principal component analysis is one of the common, yeah, and basic multivariate model that widely used, yeah. So for other model, I think probably you can explore, yeah, by yourself. Okay. So the concept of principal component analysis or PCA, yeah, is to reduce the large number of variable into few components. Yeah, I will show you the result in the next slide. So this PCA maximize the variance, which is from the eigenvalue, or explain the data by excluding redundant data. Yeah. So how to present the result? So usually we will report the R2X value, yeah, that we obtain from the model. So this value is indicating the model performance. Okay, and then usually in multivariate analysis, we will present two different figures. First is score plot, another one is learning plot. So score plot is used for evaluating observation. Probably in your study, you have a sample from different species, from different treatment, different harvest times, yeah? So this score plot is useful, yeah? To this purpose. And also from this score plot, you may analyze like outliers, yeah, if any. So the learning plot is used to evaluate the variable extracted from the spectral data, yeah, for NMR like chemical shift, yeah, and also in LC-MS probably M over Z values, yeah, this referring to the metabolites, okay, that related to the separation of the sample as shown in score plots, okay. So this is the typical result of principal component analysis model. So in this table, so this PCA we obtain using SIMCA software, yeah. So in SIMCA software, They will give the summary of the model like this. Yeah. So you can see the here R2X cumulative. Yeah. Okay. 0.076. Yeah. Which indicate the model is good. Yeah. Or excellent. Yeah. Since it is near to one. Yeah. So I must say that above 0.5, the multivariate model can be considered to be valid. Yeah. So in SIMCA, they also give Q2 cumulative value. So Q2 cumulative is referring to internal cross validation. Yeah. So this is good. Yeah. So you can confirm further whether the model, the PCA model that you use in your study is valid. Okay. So in here, yeah. When you subject the 200 variables, yeah, from the NEMA data, at the end, from PCA, it will reduce to 4 component. Okay. And then in the result, you only choose the 2 component, okay? PC1, PC2, yeah? So probably the first 2 PC, yeah, that you will choose in this score plot, yeah? Since that the first 2 PC will retain the most variation within their original data. So as we can see, you observe 2 cluster of sample, yeah. Probably is one of 2 of this is outlier. I don't know. You need to evaluate first, yeah. But basically, you will see 2 cluster, yeah, at the left side and at the right side, yeah. Just like I told you before, these 2 different cluster are separated due to there are differences in the chemical characteristic. Yeah. So how do you know? I mean, what are the variable? Yeah. In here, the metabolites that contributed to the separation of the sample in these 2 clusters, you need to see the loading plot. All right. So in here, these 2 sample separated into different cluster at the right side and the left side. So in here, all these metabolites that has been identified here at the left side are, we can say that these metabolites are presented in the higher concentration in this sample, yeah, the green sample at the left side. Okay, same goes with this metabolites at the right side. We can say that these all metabolites are highly presented in this sample, yeah, the yellow sample here. Okay, so this we call it as loading scatter plot, yeah, scatter. So we also can use loading column plot, yeah, to explain or interpret the result. Okay, until here, any question?
Okay. We have some question in the chat box. You want to answer it now or maybe after you finish the lecture?
Sorry, I didn't see the... All right. Which one from?
So can you read the... The question is from Rosbel Malo. She asks, in fishery product, which metabolomics analytic platform is recommended?
All right. I think both of them. I cannot say that NMR is better or MS is better. Yeah. First thing is you need to consider that what is your purpose of your study? Yeah, if you want to do like more to targeted analysis, so I think MS is the ideal technique. But if you want to do the untargeted analysis, NMR will be good, yeah, for you to use NMR, yeah, because of NMR is a robust, yeah, require only little requirement in the sample preparation and so on, and also reproducibility is high, so you can consider NMR. So it depending on your study, yeah. So you need to look at more what is the purpose in your study. All right. Is that answering to the question? But if you can use both, it's better, of course. Right. You're combining a multi platform metabolomic, yeah, in your study.
How about in food analysis? Do you have a recommendation which is a great advantage between NMR or MS technique?
I think both of them can be used. Yeah, no problem. We can use both of them. Yes.
Okay. That's all for question from chat box.
All right. So
for now.
So I just want to show you some case of study. Yeah, probably you will get a better picture and better idea how probably you can implement this metabolomic for the safety quality assessment of seafood. Yeah, because our topic is about seafood, right? So for example here, I just took this picture from this paper. Yeah, from this article, probably you can do further reading, yeah, to know more about the finding in this study. So in this study, yeah, the metabolic profiling of different species of fish, yeah, has been conducted using the MS spectrometry technique, yeah. So if you ask which kind of MS, there are many kind of MS specification, right? For example, in here, they use rapid evaporation ionization, right? But you can also use probably for the volatile, you can opt to APCI MS, yeah? And then for the high resolution, you can opt for the quadrupole, TOF MS, yeah. For the targeted, maybe you can use a triple quad MS, yeah. So there are many kind of MS machine that you can use. Yeah, of course, it's depending on the availability the machine, yeah, in your university, yeah, in your institute, yeah. If that particular instrument only available, you can use it, yeah. So in here, the results showing that the principal component analysis of different species of fishes show, I must say that not clear, yeah, separation between the species, yeah. So as you know that PCA is unsupervised method, okay, then in this study, there has improved the separation of the sample, yeah, of different species using supervised multivariate methods, which is linear discriminant analysis and orthogonal partially squared discriminant analysis. Okay, as you can see that the figure B and C, yeah, you can see now there has five different cluster, yeah, of the sample, okay, that clearly separated based on species. All right, so this method is useful, yeah, when you want to detect, for example, is there any fraud in the fishes? Yeah, so or probably they are mistaken identify the species. Yeah, so you can use this technique. So another example is for the authentication of shrimp, yeah, based on species and also geographical origin. So again, this study is the example of the use of LC-MS metabolomics, right? So here A and B, they use two different mode, yeah, positive ion mode and negative ion mode. So you can see also here the supervised method are managed to separate or discriminate the sample based on their species and origins, yeah, right. So I'm not sure this is a seafood, but I don't think it's not, yeah, but it's microalgae is popular, yeah, because they claim that this marine resource can provide diverse biological activity due to the presence of the compound, yeah, such as carotenoid, chlorophyll, yeah, like phenolic, right, fufa, yeah. It also has been used in food, yeah, as the ingredient in food, pharmaceutical, yeah, and cosmetic. So this microalgae, why it's very popular is the reason is also because of that this microalgae is easy to be cultivated, yeah, to be cultured. So that we may say that probably is a potential marine resources that sustain, yeah, as a sustained marine resources, yeah. Then also when we cultivate them in a optimized condition, probably the possibility to get the consistent product or the quality of the product is more, yeah, rather than, for example, you catch the fish and you stole it like that. So it's kind of difficult, yeah, to maintain, yeah, the quality of that product, yeah, fish product. So this is the result of the one of my algae, which is chlorella, that my undergraduate student has been done in her final year project using the 1H NMR metabolomics to see the metabolic changes due to different nitrogen supplementation. Yeah. So as we know that nitrogen is one of the source, yeah, for the algae to be grow. Yeah. So in here, our finding indicate that in the excess of nitrogen, the metabolite like carotenoid is highly expressed, yeah, in the sample. So C is means that control is means that the nitrogen in a common or usual amount, yeah. But in here we add the concentration of nitrogen. So as we can see here, the carotenoid has expressed in the increase of nitrogen. But when we eliminate or remove the N, or you can probably reduce the N, yeah, nitrogen. So some metabolite like fatty acid, yeah, this is the signal of fatty acid. Then chlorophyll is highly expressed in this, right? So this I must say that using different nutrient, we can also get probably different metabolites. Yeah, so this very important and useful when you, for example, targeted to some metabolites. Yeah, for example, you want omega 3, yeah, more in your sample, for example. So you know which are the nutrient, yeah, source of nutrient that you may want to add or lower. So another example here, probably is not related to the quality of the seafood, but it is important. Indicator, yeah, for the investigation of heavy metal accumulation in the fish product. In this case, we use mud crabs. That at the end also related to the safety of the human consumption. Yeah, if the human probably the implication of the consumption of that particular contaminated fish products. So in this case, we have two different sample collected from different location, right? The first location is a pristine location, which means that we assume that this location they have non-polluted area, but another location are industry area, yeah. So this mud crab has been collected from the that area, and then from our analysis, heavy metal analysis, we may know that in this industry area we got more heavy metal as compared to the another one, the non-polluted area. So using this NMR metabolomic, we also may evaluate the metabolite, what are the metabolite that alter in the polluted area as compared to non-polluted. So our finding indicate that some metabolites, yeah, from the amino acid and also organic acid has been altered. Yeah, you can see this one, red and blue. Yeah, red indicate this metabolite high in that particular sample. Blue is indicate the metabolite is low. So it's very useful, yeah, to see this. So at the end, probably from this finding, you may see the pathway, yeah, analysis. It depend on your purpose, yeah. I think I already finished the class, I think. So just I promise, probably is more short and very quick lecture, right? So for your further reading, you can refer to these references that I give to you. This is very good references for you to understand better, yeah, about the metabolomic and also the application of metabolomic in seafood. Okay, thank you so much for your attention. Once again, thank you for having me here until the end. Stay healthy and keep positive. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Marwalidiani. Your lecture is very insightful for everyone in here, because we have so many questions for you in the chat box. Before I read the question in the chat box, I also open if anybody here want to ask directly to Dr. Maulidiani, you can raise your hand. So for the first question, we have question from Therese. She asks to Dr. Maulidiani, what studies can you suggest that this metabolite may be used?
Pardon, which one? Oh,
what studies?
Just, I have mentioned in this slide. I think any study can be used. Yeah. So this the metabolomic is a tool. Yeah? Basically, it's a tool that can be applied in diverse field of study. Yeah. So which means this the application can be also many. Yeah. So again, once again, it depending on your study. Yeah. For example, if you your study is related to different treatment. Yeah, you have different treatment, or you have sample from different harvest time, or you have sample that you want to see the metabolite feature or marker from different species. So this metabolomic is very good and is very useful approach.
Okay, for the next question from Joshua, he asks, which is the best solvent for metabolomic study, ethanol or methanol?
That's why. Once again, I must say that it's also depending on your purpose. Yeah. Okay, for example, if you your option is for the solvent that less toxic, you may use ethanol or even water. Yeah. But if you are decide want to use a universal solvent, I must say methanol, because methanol in nature product in my field also it has been used because the characteristic can extract wild metabolites, yeah, from variety of metabolite can be extracted in here methanol. So some of my study, I'm not only using one solvent. Yeah, probably you also can compare between the different solvent. Yeah, from non-polar to polar. Yeah, so that way you can get the bigger overview and you can get a more comprehensive analysis of your sample that you study. Yeah.
Okay. Next question is from Kahmi. Could you please suggest which method is best used for metabolic profiling study for plant extract or seaweed extract or sea cucumber for alkaloid compound? And what is the step involved after getting the extracts? Should we purify the extract first? Or so which purification you would suggest?
All right. So that's why basically there are two approach in metabolomics, which is targeted and non-targeted. Yeah. If you are targeted for the alkaloid here, I must say you can use MS. Yeah. To do this. Yeah. But if you you want to see all compound metabolite in sea cucumber or plant extract, you may also consider NMR. Right. But in here in metabolomics, we are not what we call yeah? The main purpose is to do the profiling without to do purification step, yeah. But probably the purification or isolation of the compound needed when you identify unknown, right? Unknown compound, all right. Probably this unknown compound also has the contribution or correlation with the biological activity. Okay, this is also, you need to have validation to this result. So you need to do this isolation. But once again, for this metabolomic, we are not focusing on the verification. So focusing more to the profiling, metabolic profiling. right? Which means that not necessary for you to do purification.
Okay, so the next question is from Rosbel Malo again. She asks, do you know the limit of heavy metal on mud crabs considered as safe for consumption?
All right. For this, I need to refer to I don't know the regulation. I'm not sure about this because I'm not from the food technologies, but my interest is more to metabolite identification, or you want to see the metabolite alteration due to this factor, yeah, which is heavy metals. But I think there is limit of heavy metal, yeah, that you can consider, yeah, to be safe for the consumption. But for this, I'm sorry, I cannot answer the question.
It's okay. I think Rosbel, you should ask to the previous lecturer from lecturer 1, 2 or the in general lecturer. So next question is from Irene Diet. She asks, how can we read 1H NMR? We just read this as NMR only or 1H NMR?
All right. Yeah, I understand. Okay. So once again, this is very challenging and difficult step in metabolomic, which is to identify metabolites. Yeah, it's never been easy, right? But usually for some sample, yeah, or biological, from the biological sample, we may get idea, yeah, what kind of metabolite that possible in our sample. And we are also expected to be present in there, yeah, since it's from the biological sample. So we may, for example, expected like amino acid. You may see also the signal for the organic acid. You may see the nucleoside. You may see the carbohydrate and so on. So these are like more to primary metabolite that exist, yeah, in the biological sample. So for this identification, you can use a free software, yeah, for NMR. You can use Kinomex, yeah. I also has summarized all the software that you can use, probably will be useful in your future study. So the metabolite, like in the biological sample, for example, urine, serum, tissue, cell, yeah, they are mostly available in the library. Okay, so you can compare your signal of that particular metabolite that you want to identify, all right, with the signal of the reference compound that available in the library. So you compare the peak in your spectrum with the peak of the metabolite in the library, something like that. All right. So if, for example, the metabolite is very specific in the sample, but some study already reported on that metabolite, you can use that NMR data that previous study has been reported to do this identification. Yeah. So again, you compare the NMR signal in your sample with the signal of that metabolite that reported in the previous study. I think there are many also available and useful database that available, yeah, then also freely to access, yeah. For example, HMDB human database metabolome, yeah. So you can use that to identify and to do the elucidation of the structure. Is that answering the question?
Yes, it also answer the second question from her.
Mm-hmm.
So the next question is from Joshua Saul. He asks, in the field of lipidomics or metabolomics, how is the accurate method to achieve the comprehensive metabolite of a sample using LC-MS or MS?
All right. So to this one, you need to do some kind of validation, right? So in metabolomics, if you want the accurate result, probably you can use high resolution MS, right? And then also it's good for you to do MS-MS, yeah, as just like you saying here, because your identification also will be confirmed using the Freeman ion, yeah, rather than only MS alone, yeah, from the parent ion. So in here, using this Freeman ion, you can confirm further your identification. Once again, it's not easy, yeah, actually to do this analysis, yeah. For example, in LC-MS also, because you may get more, metabolite to be detected, yeah, than NMR, and since this is very sensitive. But this is the way how to confirm your identification, yeah, using the suitable instrument, yeah, like high resolution mass, and then using this suitable experimental method like MS-MS, or even in targeted you may use MRM, SIM, yeah. So this kind of method can help you to confirm the identification of the metabolites.
Okay, we have the last question in the chat box from Joan Faye. She asks, what are the current and emerging application of metabolomics in aquatic biotechnology?
I'm not sure I'm not the I'm the perfect person to answer this, since I think I also quite new in this field, yeah, in this aquatic biotechnology metabolomics, yeah. So for your information, my current study is more to plant herbal, but I am shifting also to this aquatic products, yeah. But probably the current issue, yeah, that we are dealing here is on the just now I am presenting is probably contamination, yeah, of the food, yeah. For example, due to heavy metal or other chemicals, yeah. For example, usually, especially in a industry or a polluted area, yeah. So this is you need to take into the consideration, and also food, fish prout, yeah, which means that the fish is mistakenly identified to that species, yeah. It's different, right? But they identify to be the species that. Not correct identification. So probably these are the current issue, yeah, in this metabolomic for aquatic biotechnology. All right.
Sorry, Dr. Maulidiani, we have another question.
Okay, it's all right.
It's from Kahmei from USM. Right. How NMR and FDA are differ in analysis?
All right. So both of these tools, yeah, analytical instrument can be used for the metabolite fingerprint, yeah, for the chemical profile, right? But the difference between these analytical tools, I may say that like FDIR, you can use it for screening, yeah, because it's cheap, yeah. It's fast, so it's probably is a cost-effective method, yeah, a spectroscopy method to use in metabolomic. But for FDIR, you cannot get the clear picture what are the metabolites. The metabolite means that you know the exact structure of that metabolite using FDIR, since FDIR only focus on the analysis of the functional group of the metabolite, yeah. So you cannot get the clear analysis on the chemical structure, yeah, of the metabolite. So unlike NMR or LC-MS, you may get that. You can analyze the structure of the metabolite. Okay.
Okay. And we have another question. From Andrean Wangsa.
Right.
Is it okay?
Okay. No problem.
From Andrean Wangsa, from IUB. Right. Between GC and LC-MS, which one are more preferable in metabolite analysis?
All right. So once again, yeah, if in your institute or in university you only have GC, you don't have LC-MS, you can always use it, GC, right? If you have LC-MS, it's better. You can use LC-MS. Why is better? Yeah, because LC-MS is more universal detector. It doesn't require any derivatization procedure. Yeah, in the sample preparation. Yeah, because in GC, you may need to do that step in order for you to what we call it, the compound to be more volatile. Yeah, in the instrument, because GC usually we use it for the volatile compound, okay. But we can make it detect in GC, but you need to do the derivatization. So once again, it's a little bit tedious to do that. But if you don't have any option, you can always use any instrument in your institute, right?
Oh,
all right.
There is an extra question. How about HPLC? So
yes.
Between GC, LC-MS, and HPLC.
Right. Okay. I'm gonna say can, but disadvantages of LC-MS, you may need standard compound. Yeah, because the analysis in LC, in HPLC is solely be based on retention time. Yeah, the peak will come up in HPLC analysis based on retention time, right? But you don't know what is that. Only peak, you know, right? So in order to confirm and validate your result, you need a standard compound. Of course, you need to study the literature. Yeah? What are the compound that probably expected to be present in your sample?
Oh,
right.
Okay. So in, wow, you have another question.
Okay, it's all right.
From Asida Rahman, for seafood in the industry, is metabolic analysis used as an addition or as a must in safety equality assessment? Is it a must use or
I must say
additional?
That why not? Why not we use it for the safety and quality assessment, since this method is robust, okay, can provide the comprehensive analysis. Yeah, you may also can cut cost and time in analysis. For example, if you do conventional approach, yeah, so you may need to do many analysis, but use this technique like metabolomic, you may get a comprehensive result, something like that. Why not?
Oh, yeah.
Bye.
Okay, so Mr. Solomon, do you want to ask a question? Mr. Solomon? Do you want to ask question? Okay, no. So we already answer all the question. Thank you to Dr. Maulidiani for your lecture and knowledge.
Welcome.
I think everyone in here get insightful knowledge. So before we end this meeting, shall we take a picture? I forgot to take picture in the previous lecturer. So let's take picture. Sorry, Pak Roni.
Today's lesson is about omics. We have a proteomics before. And
omics. Yeah, very excited lecture, right?
Yeah.
The participant is very active, and I must say they are probably excited to this topic also.
Yeah.
I'm glad to see that. Right. Mm.
Yeah, I think proteomics and metabolomics and managing technologies and you know it is exploiting LC-MS, MS.
All
right. So who's gonna take a picture? Would it be?
Okay. Let's take a picture. Dimas or Indah?
Both mom.
Okay, please Dimas. From I have 5 tabs. How about you?
From
in the my PC, 3 slides.
Okay.
Yeah, because you have a bigger screen, I think.
Please lead this photo session, Dimas.
Okay. Ready?
Ready.
Yes.
Play 1, 2, 3, screen 1, cheese. Okay, next, screen 2. Wow, okay. 1, 2, 3, say cheese. Okay, screen 3. Oh, no, but in on cam, ma'am.
It's okay, just take the picture. Okay.
I take the screenshot, but not on cam.
Okay, so thank you so much for the lecture, Dr. Maulidiani. After this, the student will fill the quiz from you.
All right. I hope you can answer correctly on this question.
I hope everyone have a high score in this because Dr. Maulidiani already give a very
easy, easy question.
Yeah. Easy question for you. So I think that's all for today. Thank you for your absence. Don't forget to fill your absence. Mr. Dimas already will give the link for attendance, the quiz and attendance. Thank you so much for today.
Okay, see you again tomorrow for
midterm
presentation.
Yeah, tomorrow you will have midterm presentation. Good luck, everyone.
Thank you.
Only for yeah. Thank you, Dr. Maulidiani.
Okay. Bye bye.
Bye.
Bye. Hope we can see it again.
See you again. Or is there any question for tomorrow?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. How about the sequence, ma'am, of reporting?
Oh, yeah.
It's be followed alphabetically or draw lots?
Okay.
You will draw lots. Who will be okay. The first one to report?
Yeah. This video is about the sequence for presentation. Is it follow the you know from ABCD or we have
or the course you want to submit?
Okay, I think we're gonna give you like a schedule for the presentation. I believe you don't need to stay. I mean, from 1 o'clock till four o'clock, you can just come in when your time when I think when your presentation is about to happen. And the rest, yeah, I think you didn't like. I think we will distribute the schedule tonight. Who's gonna be the first one tomorrow, and the second, and then the third, and so on. So it's gonna be a E, C, D, and E, F, G, but yeah, we can just like a random who's gonna be the first, second, and third. I think that's all. And we'll give you the time as well. So you just you can just join enter the Zoom meeting.
We will just be
2 minutes or 3 minutes before your presentation time.
Okay. So we cannot view the other presentation?
You may.
We may. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay.
Sir.
Okay. No worries.
Bye bye.
Good afternoon, Mr. Ronnie.
Yes.
I would like to ask, do we need to submit the presentation slides or we just share screen on that schedule time?
I believe that you just need to share your screen. You don't need to submit your presentation at this point. Maybe probably later during the final presentation, you need to submit.
All right, thank you, sir.
Okay, let's spin the wheel. Yes,
sir. Sir, good afternoon.
Yes, Irene.
Yeah, good afternoon, Irene. Yes.
Sir, ma'am, we will present in a PowerPoint presentation, right? Not in a poster.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. For tomorrow, you need to prepare a PowerPoint presentation. Because I believe 3 minutes, maybe you have two or three slides. You have a background, so you have a problem statement. It won't fit in one slide, maybe, I believe. So it's better to use a PowerPoint presentation.
Sir, again, same with the final presentation.
Yep. Yes, final presentation should be on PowerPoint because you have 10 minutes and probably gonna have 10 slides. Then PowerPoint presentation is better.
Okay, thank you.
Sir?
Yes, Joanna?
Sir, just for clarification, about for the midterm presentation tomorrow, we will be presenting worldwide seafood problem. And does it also include the status or what are the current situation now with regards to the solution now that we are going to approaching to? Or the problem only?
For I think this question part of the problem. Usually when you present a problem, you will kind of present the current situation, and then you analyze from the current situation what is the problem of the current situation, and then next in the final presentation you propose some solution for those problems.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So it will just end on the problem, sir.
Yeah. On the problems.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions or clarification? Otherwise, I think Burisvi, we can close this and
I will end this meeting. Thank you, everyone.
Okay.
See you again
Thank
tomorrow.
You
Good
See
luck
you
for the midterm presentation.
Bye.
I hope you prepare well.